So my understanding is that the sponges are locked away until the end of the panel, right? I heard that there was a very lively debate on this topic at last year's meeting, which I missed. So we're expecting a good deal of participation in this one. So we have four panelists. I'm not sure why Aileen's name is underlined and the others aren't. Aileen is going to speak first, but a brief review of the history of peer review before Aileen gives you a complete one. I do not take pictures of this. I do not have clearance for reproduction of that. The debate over expertise, you probably, in this country, you recognize that as the FT. The concept of experts being in charge is an ancient one. This happened to be about wine reviews. Certainly something that has been transformed by online wine reviews, online wine apps, and so on. So the whole culture is going through a change in the concept of expertise, locking away certain things from distribution. Certain wines wouldn't even get into much distribution if the reigning experts hadn't rated them 90 or above. I wanted to briefly, in the States we'd say pimp, I'm not sure that's the right word here. this is an extraordinarily thorough report. Michael Jubb, as far as I know, was the prime author on this report. Maybe the sole author on this report. and I really recommend it to you, despite the long URL for the welcome site. This report, if you are interested in what are the experiments going on in peer review, this report is the catalog raisonné of them, at least probably until it's a year old. So if you are part of an editorial team, that is, or talking to editors in your fall editorial board meetings about peer review and possible experiments, you really should take a look at this and see whether someone else is already working in an area that Michael's reported on. These are our panelists, and Aileen is going to speak first. She is a professor whose specialization is in the history of science communication. And so one of the first things she'll do is ground us in an understanding of how peer review has evolved. You know, many of us, especially if you've worked in the industry perhaps only the last 10 years, everything looks new. And I think from a perspective of 300 or so years of history, in fact, a lot of things do come around again and again. The panelists in this order, we're going to each speak. Then at the end, after Kirsty has spoken, we'll all come up to the front, have a short intra-panel dialogue, and then turn it over to the audience with the sponges locked away. Thank you very much. Kirsty.
Thank you. Right, so peer review is often held up to be fundamental to the making of scientific knowledge. And it's also often said, including in the RIN report that we've just referred to have been part of science communication, science publishing since the start, which is usually dated to 1665, the history, the foundation of philosophical transactions of the Royal Society. And my research team works on the history of philosophical transactions. And what I want to do today is give you a very whistle-stop tour through six key moments in the history of scientific journals and to consider how decisions were being made about what should be published. And what I'm trying to do here is to bring your attention to questions of who is making the decision, on what grounds are they making that decision, what's the purpose of making those decisions. In other words, I'm trying to get you to think about what peer review has been about, what it might be about, what it ultimately should be about, which I hope will lead into our discussions later. So let us start with the origins of philosophical transactions. This is Henry Oldenburg, the first secretary of the Royal Society. And he had the idea for this new kind of genre, the scientific periodical. He thought it would be a monthly news sheet. It's a different kind of publication from the journals that any of you will be involved with now, where authors submit papers on research findings to editors who then think about whether to include them or not. In Henry Oldenburg's day, in Henry Oldenburg's day, we're talking about a time when Oldenburg manages and curates and collects this. Every month he's got a copy deadline. He's got to think about, do I have enough stuff to put in this? I've got to fill my pages. I need to get material from somewhere. Okay, so it's an editor-driven model, where Oldenburg is trying to find copy from wherever he can. He's got a very extensive correspondence network all across Europe. He puts extracts of that into his magazine. He's also relying upon what's going on at the Royal Society, the lectures and demonstrations that take place there, and some of that goes into philosophical transactions. He also has book reviews and reviews of pamphlets and treatises that are coming out. There's a lot of different miscellaneous kind of content in there, and it's utterly Henry Oldenburg's periodical. He makes the decisions about what goes in, okay? Now, you might be thinking, so why does anyone say peer review starts then? You can take Oldenburg as a peer, if you will. But there is some oversight of this, because you need to realize that in early modern Europe, there's no such thing as a free press. There are state licensing requirements in operation across Europe. And in Britain, the Royal Society is in a very unusual situation, because it has the right to be its own licensing agency. Very few organizations have that right. The Royal Society does. And that means it doesn't have to submit its publications to any other form of censorship. The president of the society can license things for publication. And that's why all the early copies of Philosophical Transactions have some statement either about printed with license or printed under the imprimatur of the Royal Society. But the question here is, what does that imprimatur mean? So yes, the president has approved this for publication, but what has he approved? He hasn't approved at the article level, he's approving at the level of the issue. And what he's certifying there is nothing about the intellectual content of the knowledge claims being put forward here. He is certifying that there is nothing dangerous to the crown. There is no treason or sedition or blasphemy, you know, nothing of that sort in there. So yes, there's some form of oversight going on here, but it's not the sort of thing you'd be expecting from peer review. I might also raise the question of whether the president of the Royal Society, who is a peer in the British aristocratic sense most of the time, but not necessarily a peer in the sense we now use it when we talk about peer review. So we've got, I'm going to have a table in this at the end of each of my 6 points just to get you thinking, who's involved? It's the president. He's checking for licensing requirements, not for intellectual content, and that's why. Now let's fast forward to the 18th century. By 1752, the Royal Society has formally taken over the management and control of philosophical transactions. It now becomes a society journal rather than one man's periodical. And as societies so often do in these sorts of situations, and I'm sure many of you are aware, is they set up a committee. So we get the creation of a committee of papers, an editorial committee, okay? Because what's happening here is the society is putting its name to this now. So it's important to the society's reputation that it's not seen as being the property of an individual who may be biased, prejudiced, or just mistaken. There has to be some sort of corporate collective responsibility behind this, and the committee structure provides that. What the committee are doing is, according to the top quote, they're reconsidering the papers that have been read before the society. So we are now in a situation where authors are sending in research papers to be read at the society, and this committee then considers which ones are worthy of publication. But what are they doing? They, at their committee meetings, they are looking at the abstracts of papers and deciding whether to publish. They're not looking at the full text of the papers, because that would take far too long in a committee, as you can imagine. They're looking at the abstracts, and they're taking a vote. About secret ballot, allegedly, though whether we believe that is another matter, but it's what they're supposed to be doing. They're not checking the truth value of individual claims. What they're trying to do is protect the society's reputation from some of the accusations that had hounded earlier philosophical transactions of frivolity and trivia, of including things that were not worthy of being included under the name of the Royal Society. Things like schemes for perpetual motion machines, reports of monstrous births, you know, women giving birth to rabbits and children vomiting worms, these kinds of things that are not deemed to be, you know, serious natural philosophy. So they're excluding that, okay? So it's a triaging of weeding out stuff rather than a more positive statement about value. And I put this quote here because this preface appeared at the front of Philosophical Transactions through the 18th century, the 19th century, into the 20th century. And what it claims is that although the society has chosen what to print, they are not pretending to answer for the certainty of the facts or propriety of the reasonings contained, which must still rest on the credit or judgment of their respective authors. The Royal Society's imprimatur on this does not say, we believe this to be true. It doesn't say we've checked this. It says, we think it's sound, it's worth putting out there, but it's up to the author to vouch for the truth claims. Keep that in mind when I take you across the channel to what the French are up to. What the French at this point in time are doing at the Académie Royale des Sciences, they also have a committee, by the way, is that they are developing a system of rapporteurs. The committee sometimes makes decisions, but sometimes refers papers to experts, to members of the Academy. The Royal Society theoretically could do this, but it just doesn't do it very often. The French do it more often. So what we're seeing, sorry, there's no laser pointer in this, is records from the archives of papers being referred to named individuals, Lavoisier and Bailly in this case, are asked to report on this as a joint report. You're thinking collaborative peer review is exciting and new? Nah, French were doing it ages ago. So we've got joint reports being issued. And what are they being asked to report on? It is the truth claims. They're being asked to scrutinize the actual truth claims being made in these papers, whether that means repeating the observations, repeating the experiments, and saying, yeah, actually, this is right, or no, actually, we don't get the same results, or we don't agree with interpretations. So a report from the Academy's rapporteurs is a statement at this point in time about the truth quality, the truth value of these claims. So that's very different from what the British are doing at this point in time. But let me make two points about that in terms of who's doing it. Members of the Academy are doing this judging. They do not judge each other. Their papers don't get reported on in this way. They only judge outsiders who are submitting claims to the judgment of the Academy. So this is not peer review, it's perhaps more judicial review. It's a different form of evaluation. Also worth noting that the French abandoned this high level of checking and scrutiny in the 1830s because it was deemed to be unsustainable. So you might want to bear that in mind when you think about what you want peer review to achieve. Now, let's come back across the channel to Britain. And in the 1830s, 40s, 50s, what the Royal Society and other learned societies in Britain are doing is making more use of what we would now call refereeing. Individually written reports rather than joint ones, but the introduction of written referees reports, not to do away with the committee structure, but to supplement the committee structure. So what we see developing in the learned societies in Britain at this point in time is a committee structure that gives you the collective editorial responsibility, that you can put the name of the society on it, but also the use of referees to give you specialist expertise, because in an age of growing specialization, the chances of the committee, including someone with all the relevant expertise, is getting rather slim. The referees are always fellows of the society. So the question of who's involved here is it's members of the society. The fact that it's a community, a society, I think is important, by the way. What the referees are doing, well, some of them are writing quite a lot. This is just the first and last pages of a 5-page report saying, yes, recommend publication. It takes 5 pages to say that. We've got referees who are spending quite a lot of time reading the full text of these papers and commenting on whether there's any glaring errors. So there's still that weeding out any obvious errors kind of thing. But they're also doing things like saying, oh, so-and-so might have reason beyond what the results suggest, or saying lots of things about literary style, you know, waffly introduction, could you cut it down and get to the point sooner, and maybe you want to restructure this. So literary comments about the scientific article. We're seeing something that's much more, I would say, like, not so much a judgment, yes or no, but revisions, mentoring, a work in progress, a discussion between colleagues, I'd suggest. And I think it's significant that the referees at the Royal Society are refereeing each other's work. They're not just sitting in judgment upon the work of others. It's fellows of the Royal Society writing about each other's work and also about outsiders as well. But you could see those outsiders perhaps as future fellows of the Royal Society, the younger members of the community in waiting. So we've got a different model going on here. We've still got that denial that this is about assessing the truth value. So it's still about saying, it looks sound, it looks plausible, it looks interesting, let's publish it. The Royal Society does run into problems, as other learned societies do, when there's more and more plausible and worthy papers arriving. And in the days of paper and ink, there are limits on what they can afford to publish. But that's a sort of different story for now. So we've got not just the president anymore, not just the council, we've got all the fellowship of the society potentially involved in refereeing. And they're actually looking at the full paper, not just abstracts, but they're not testing facts, they're looking for that originality and significance and plausibility. Now, by the time we get to the end of the 19th century, most of the learned societies seem to have developed some variety of this system with committees and referees. But there's a whole lot of other journals that don't do anything like this at all. Basically all the commercial journals, the ones that are not associated with societies. So for instance, Philosophical Magazine and Nature would be another example. Those journals continue to be very much run by their editors, just as Henry Oldenburg ran the transactions way back in the beginning. They're driven by their editors, they make decisions about what to publish. And these magazines also tend to be aimed at a they have different contents. They're not just research papers. They tend to have more newsy stuff, more book reviews, more news of what's going on in the world of science. A little bit like Nature, of course, still has that content as well as its research papers. These are magazines that are commercial products produced to find paying customers, whereas the Transactions of the Learned Societies do a lot of their distribution through membership of the society and through exchanges with other societies. This commercial stuff is not quite so important to them. So these are different sorts of journals. They're still run by their editors. Why are the editors choosing? How are they choosing? Well, in the case of PhilMag in the early 20th century, the editors are all active men of science. So they themselves, there is an editorial team, but they themselves could be said to be, you know, peers sitting in judgment on what comes in. But what's interesting about the example I've got here, Sir Oliver Lodge, well-known physicist of the 1920s. And he approved the publication in 1925 of a paper by Felix Ehrenhaft, which has to do with new physics. This is post-Einstein. There's lots of debates about what approach physics is going to take. And Ehrenhaft's paper, says Lodge, was basically badly written. And moreover, Lodge reckoned it was wrong because Ehrenhaft came from the other side of the debate in physics at that point in time. But Lodge wanted to publish it. So for Lodge, the decision to publish is not about, I think this paper is right. It's, I think this paper is a worthy contribution to the debate. This is currently a time of great change in physics. There are disagreements about this. We're going to have both sides in Philosophical Magazine. So my point here is it doesn't imply, the publication does not imply believing the truth of these papers at this point in time. Now let's give you another example from Nature. Once we move into the 1950s, Nature also still very much run by its editors, not using referees in any regular fashion whatsoever. I mean, editors do occasionally ask their mates, and you know, what do you think of this paper? But no formal refereeing going on. And what I like about this quotation from a former editorial staff member at Nature is, well, firstly, the implication that almost anything could get into Nature at this point in time and how things change. But almost anything could get in if it wasn't actually wrong. Notice again that sense of, as long as it's not obviously glaringly wrong, looks plausible, looks worthy of being put out there for discussion. Also notice the comment that the editors might have taken more notice of where it came from than the content. Now, the editors of Nature at that point in time, and had been since the early 20th century, were not eminent men of science like Oliver Lodge was. They were professional science editors. They had science degrees, but they weren't themselves practicing scientists. So it's a different type of person who's editing the sort of journal that Nature is. Remember, it is a different sort of journal from the Transactions. They have to find things that are interesting and newsworthy. They themselves may not have the kind of reputational moral authority to judge things. So what do? They rely on stuff that comes from good institutions, Cambridge, King's College London, you know, Harvard, these kinds of places, that, you know, we'll take stuff from there, and especially if it comes from a laboratory we know or whose head we know. So when in 1953 Watson and Crick were discussing where to put their double helix paper on DNA, I mean, frankly, they didn't seem to have discussed it. It was obviously going to Nature because it was a very quick publication outlet. But they discussed it with the head of the Cavendish, Lawrence Bragg. And Bragg supports this and suggests that he will write to the editor of Nature recommending publication of their paper. Now, why would the head of the laboratory think that's a worthwhile thing to do? It implies something about the decision-making process at Nature, that the fact it comes from Cambridge, the fact that it's endorsed or sponsored by eminent person that we've heard of, is enough to make sure, yeah, okay, we'll take it. It's got to be worth putting out there for further discussion. So a very different sense of who's making the decision and on what grounds you're making that decision. And what I'm trying to do here is get you thinking about how different the rationales have been for editorial decision making at different points in the past. And so I hope that you have now seen that there have been these different ways of doing things, that there have been different power relations between who is judging and who is being judged or evaluated or reviewed, whatever you want to call it. And I think we need to think very seriously about what it is we really expect our referees nowadays to be doing. I feel that a lot of the critique of peer review now has been based on really rather unrealistic expectations of what peer review should be doing. That people wish it was doing what the French were doing in the 18th century and really testing the science. But I'd remind you, the French gave up on that model as unsustainable. We probably don't want to check for blasphemy or sedition these days, but we do still want to weed out, I assume, the obviously erroneous or indeed the previously published and therefore not original. But what is it that peer review should be doing, and who do we want to be the peers who do it? Until we agree on those sorts of things about what is it, who does it, and why are we actually doing this, I don't see how we can start redesigning peer review for the modern scholarly world until we've made those decisions. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to do this. As Aileen has just shown us so fantastically, the history of peer review is not perhaps as simple as many of us practitioners might imagine. But I think she wouldn't argue with the fact that by the time the end of the 20th century rolled around, peer review was a central pathway in the process of scientific communication. However, as we have moved into the 21st century, I think we could also say that that pathway is awash in doubt and criticism. And that criticism is coming from many quarters and some quite significant ones. Here is the editor of The Lancet, no less, who seems to think that science has taken a very bad turn and that half of it may actually, what is published may actually not be true. Another prominent medical editor, Richard Smith, who describes peer review in particular as ineffective, slow, expensive, irrelevant, but apart from that, it's perfectly okay. And then there is Mike Eisen with his typically diffident approach to this question. He too has a long list of adjectives basically saying that we are in a post-peer review world and that there are much better ways of doing things. And those who are inclined to defend basically have to fall back on this much-tested dictum from a variation on the Churchillian idea that, well, okay, it may not be perfect, but it's the best that we have. If you talk to scientists, and there are many surveys that basically all say the same thing, that most scientists are actually pretty satisfied with peer review. They think that it helps the scientific enterprise more generally, but also, maybe quite remarkably, they actually think it has helped their own papers get better. And this seems to be independent of whether the paper was actually in question was actually published or not, or accepted or not, I should say. However, a pretty large proportion of scientists also think that the peer review process could be improved by training particularly young people in how to do it better, by having editors make better decisions about who to send the paper to, expanding the pool of reviewers, particularly as the scientific enterprise grows more internationally, and always, always, always making it faster. A lot of people think that the more innovative and fringe or imaginative the science, then the less likely it is to do well in conventional peer review. And another concern is that with more and more journals and more science and more scientists, that the current practice of peer review is unsustainable, and as the French concluded a long time ago, as Aileen told us. So what should peer review actually accomplish? And here is a list of the kinds of things that conventionally peer review is expected to do. Some of that is to assist the editors in making the final determination. How original is it? How important are these findings in the context of the field? Is appropriate acknowledgement given to past work? And ultimately, should this paper be accepted by the journal? They also think that the peer review process should find malfeasance of one kind or another. However, most scientists think that particularly with these two latter goals, that the process does not work very well. So there are a very large number of experiments going on in how to improve the process of peer review, and they are affecting many aspects of how the process works, as I have listed here. And in the short time available to us, I cannot go through all in detail exactly what these experiments are. But here is a list of the kinds of things that are being done by some or several journals. Broadly speaking, I think these fall into two categories. One is more transparency about the process itself. That would include things like identifying reviewers by name, publishing the reviews alongside the papers, or encouraging back and forth in a public way between reviewers and authors. Some of it is to do with making the process more efficient, such as the ability to bring reviews from one journal to another if a paper doesn't pass muster at the first hurdle. And some of it is the use of technology to basically improve the process, such as software for detecting plagiarism or looking for over-enthusiastic manipulation of figures. More recently, some of the manuscript submission systems are building in processes for validating reviewers as being appropriate, because there are instances now of people gaming the system, basically inventing reviewers to whom they suggest the editors contact. And so some journals have decided that they are simply going to rule out any possibility that authors will have the chance to suggest reviewers. Changing where it's done, basically, by what I mean by this, is the old idea of the community that surrounds a journal that, again, Aileen referred to, that is being changed in some ways to outsource the process of peer review to specialist companies or platforms that who themselves recruit scientists to do this work, and journals contract with those companies to provide this peer review service. And here are just a list of some of those companies that are active in this way. Again, I don't have time to sort of debate the merits of each one. Some of these companies are also concerned with something I'm sure we'll talk about, which is the process of assigning credit to people for actually doing the reviews. As far as changing when the process happens is concerned, well, there is a great deal of interest in post-publication peer review. This based on the idea that the peer review process pre-publication is imperfect, that literature, that papers once published, need to be examined, critiqued, and their flaws publicly exposed. There are a number of ways in which that can happen. Most journals have commenting functions. On the whole, they are in biology, certainly they are not used very extensively. PubMed has a process called PubMed Commons, which is not open to everyone, but to people who have published papers, which are deposited in PubMed. PubPeer has achieved a significant amount of notice or notoriety lately by revealing various flaws in published papers. You might have seen the announcement that they're about to create a foundation that will allow them to expand their activities. ResearchGate and academia are essentially social networks where commenting on papers is possible. And Science Open and selectedpapers.net have different takes on this. But again, there is the opportunity on these sites to comment publicly on published papers. Rather than do this commenting or scrutiny after publication, an alternative approach is to do it before publication. The elephant in the room, I think. Obviously, any scholar can put her work on a website. On the whole, discoverability becomes a problem. Institutional repositories are very keen to make this part of their remit, and there was an announcement of newly announced initiative to basically bolt on a peer review module to institutional repositories. That's an open-air project. Some journals have adopted a model in which they basically post a paper first, seek comment on it publicly and privately, and then decide on the basis of those comments whether they will publish it or not. But perhaps the best pre-publication mechanism, the best known pre-publication mechanism, is of course the preprint service. And the mother and father of preprint services is the long established preprint server which began in physics and now is expanded to mathematics and other areas, archive, an absolutely central part of the publication in the physics community in particular. As of nearly 2 years ago, there is now the equivalent of archive for biology, which came from my organization, Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory. We began this because we are already, as an institution, active in various forms of scientific communication and have been for a long time. So a service of this kind was pretty much within the mission of the institution. We also are very much in touch with the scientific community and heard these complaints about the fact that if you are an expert in the field, why do you need peer review to tell you whether a paper is any good or not? Let me make my own judgment. There are lots of complaints about the speed of communication. And another complaint, particularly from younger investigators, is the fact that if they don't have a strong track record but a lot of papers in press, those papers are not available to grant giving or hiring committees. So another factor was that out of frustration, some non-quantitative biology was appearing on the archive. So we felt that this was sufficient impetus to begin BioArchive, which is it's a not-for-profit, free service. It basically distributes draft papers for open comment. And we don't have screening, not even for sedition or blasphemy. We do have screening, but not for sedition and blasphemy. But we do not have peer review. And authors can revise their papers at any time. And unlike some other preprint initiatives, this is not affiliated with a specific journal. And it covers all of biology. These are some of the features of BioArchive, which I think you can read without my having to go through them. But I think the important points here is that there is a commenting function, and we also are careful that people can find the previous versions of the paper, but also we link to the finally published version of the paper, so that there is the chance to see a history of the evolution of that particular work. And we feel that the benefits of this are the rapid transmission, of course. The question of precedence is, I think, an open question. That is not something that we can determine. That's a community-based decision. But it certainly gives visibility to the work of the authors, and as I said, it makes the work available to anybody who needs to scrutinize work that is not yet in the formal published literature. So how is this going? Not to spend too much time on this, but we have just exceeded 2,000 manuscripts. They come from a very wide variety of places. We are seeing, with every month that passes, increased rates of submission and usage. There is, even in areas that are very conservative about these things, like cancer research and cell biology, there are preprints, but there is obviously a lot of a skew there towards the more quantitative sciences where people are already familiar with the archive. And one thing is clear, that at the moment, most of the manuscripts eventually appear in journals. It may be rather a long time before that happens, but they do, and they are appearing in journals that one has heard of. I think we, roughly speaking, if you look at it, it's about 30% of the existing manuscripts that have appeared in journals, but if you take into account this long delay, it's more like 70%. So the question, of course, for this occasion is, well, do preprints help in the sense of improving peer review in some fashion? Do authors get more comments pre-publication, more constructive comments pre-publication? Does eventually the paper, is it easier on the reviewers if the paper has gone through this process in advance? And will eventually preprints have some benefit to the anxieties about reproducibility and retractions? Now, of course, it is way, way too early to even attempt to answer those sorts of questions. What we do know is that 30% of these papers are being revised, and as I said, about a third of them have been published in journals, and there is a tremendous amount of feedback going on through blogs, through Twitter, 25,000 tweets, thanks to you and Adi and his organization. There, about 10% of the papers have comments associated with them, and anecdotally, I feel that if there is one, there is more likely to be more than one. But the most frequent way in which authors are getting feedback is through private email. And here's an example of one author who is very happy to hear from the editor of a prominent journal that editor would like to see his submitted manuscript. So, and another part of what we're doing with developing BioArchive is integrating it with journals so that it's possible for certain journals now to deposit your manuscript on BioArchive while submitting it to the journal for consideration. And soon we will have the reverse process in which someone can elect to submit their preprint directly to a journal. So, what can we say so far? Well, not a tremendous amount, but we can certainly say that the behavior of biologists is changing. More people are presenting preprints, more people are reading preprints and finding them valuable. Journals are changing their policies about preprints. I heard just last night from an organization I've been corresponding with that they have worked through this anxiety about preprints and they are changing their policies. There are many, many journals now that are perfectly friendly towards manuscripts that have been preprinted. And in the States, the so-called biosketch, which used to insist that only formally published journal articles were presented to NIH to support a grant application, they have changed the nature of the biosketch. So now digital objects of all kinds, including preprints, are justifiable in that context. So further along from that lakeside walk in China that I showed you earlier, I took this photograph, and this reminds me that for many people, peer review in its traditional fashion is still the gospel. And going back to this very estimable RIN report that has been mentioned so far, it contains these important warnings that the community is going to be what determines how peer review is done, and while all these experiments are going on, if they get too far ahead of what the scientists really want to do, and it's not clear what the purpose of these new ways of doing peer review are, then they will not work. And I would back up what John said earlier about the value of Michael's report. It really is very much worth reading. Thank you very much.
Wow, bright lights. So, good morning, everybody. I did manage to stay to the end of the quiz and did manage not to win, as usual, but hopefully this will be slightly more entertaining. What a handsome fellow. Okay. Unfortunately, you get the obligatory view of the university, because I'm from a university. This is the best view of the university. You'll notice it's not actually of the university, but the view from the university looking down on Canterbury. I think all of our prospectuses show this view and not the lovely 1960s concrete and glass. It was last weekend our 50th anniversary, so again, I have to bore you with that and some stats. I've mentioned the quiz, so see if I can warm you up a little bit. We have a couple of our, well, alumni, one honorary doctorate to the guy in red, and alumni to the lady posing like that. Can you see who they are?
E.L. James.
E.L. James, we know what you read. and the honorary doctorate, can you make him out? Well done, sitting at the front, okay. And I might come back to honorary doctorates later on. Also, another slide to show that we are in plenty of places, and I had to travel literally miles to get here. Wow, another honorary doctorate. Okay, one more sort of advertising slide, and then we're onto the good stuff. I'm a kind of outsider in so many ways, I hear you say. And I thought I'd give you a little bit of background as to what I am and where I'm from and why I might be saying some of the things that you're going to hear me say. I'm a research manager and administrator, and proud of it. We have an association, and if you're interested in the sort of things that those strange people in the Central University office do, either to help or hinder academic staff, come along and we'll tell you all about it. We are 25 years old this year. Our lovely conference venue is Birmingham. But in a couple of years' time, we'll be hosting the International Association, where all the 15 or so associations from across the world gather, and we'll be in Edinburgh. So if you only come to one Research Management Administration conference, that'll be the one to go to, and there will be whiskey. Okay, so peer review. It is all to do with journal articles and conference proceedings. We've heard all about that, but perhaps we can expand it out a little bit. We've also heard a little bit yesterday about monographs and other forms of long output and how peer review, you know, works in that way. Again, it's all straightforward. You're all happy. You all understand all of that. We also heard a little bit about research data and how that's perhaps a little more complicated. It's all new. It's all exciting. Nobody knows about what metadata should be included. So, yeah, but we're kind of there. And then there's all that other stuff. There's that performance, the dance, the physical object, the sculpture, whatever it might be, other forms of scholarly output. But of course, from my point of view, there are these project proposals. Now, they've been mentioned once, but a project is quite often something which will lead to a publication. If you want funding to do your projects, you probably have to submit it somewhere. Wellcome Trust, research councils, whatever. And rather than this just giving you the money, they ask people to peer review it. So I'll talk a little bit about that as well. And it's perhaps, I think, a larger part of the dynamic which we should consider. Yeah, what the hell does that mean, Simon? Well, as part of the research excellence framework in the UK, we have a 6-yearly peer review process of the research which goes on. Research outputs is one chunk of that. Research environment is another chunk of that. So 15% of your overall score, if you like, or your overall money, is based on how good your research environment is deemed to be by your peers. And they've also added a new element on research impact as well. So again, you know, we might talk about that later on, but it's not just publications, it's all these other things associated with the research endeavor. And of course, that then leads on to things like league tables, which kind of aren't really peer-reviewed, but sort of might be based on some peer-reviewed data. Of course, we shouldn't forget that the main reason for doing peer review is because it's kind of a good thing to do. It keeps you as an academic on top of your subject, gives you access to information more quickly, except, of course, if it's in something like bioarchive, in which case you see it straight away anyway. But it is that contributing, giving back. So I think most academics do involve themselves in peer review because it's a good thing to do. However, academics are people, and they quite like the idea of being promoted, and so they think that maybe this peer review thing might be something that we might take part in order to show that I'm a good person, and I'll talk a little bit about that. It's kind of also related to esteem. Your profile grows, you're better known, and you're more likely to be asked to do something, be involved in a project, or collaborate on an output, for example. Yeah, time and money, I will talk about a little bit later on. They're a bit sordid, the bottom one anyway, but time is perhaps very precious and something which can be given for people doing peer review. Yeah, you may not think so. Okay, so promotion. As I've said, it's a good thing to do, but quite a lot of universities have citizenship, or whatever they might call it, as part of their promotion criteria. It's quite often one of the 4 or 5 main bullet points. So, if you like, if you do a lot of peer reviewing, or you do it in good places or prestigious places, then you may be recognized in the promotion process. It might be that you have an internal mentoring process or some internal peer review within your department. And again, that might be recognized in promotion. So it's kind of part of that citizenship, but perhaps more structured. So it might be that rather than you saying, look at all this great stuff, it might be that the criteria specifically say, have you been involved in the departmental peer review process? Similarly, you may do it externally. You might have, you might be mentoring a member of academic staff from another institution. And of course, your university is really happy about that. Indeed, you probably will develop, you'll become a reviewer for a journal or a series of journals or even an editor. And those things look pretty good on your CV when you're putting in for a promotion. I talked about peer review for funders, and sometimes this can be recognized. Often it's this kind of either single blind or sometimes double blind reviewing process, so the reviewers aren't always known, but quite often a reviewer might have, a funder might have a peer review college. So here are the 297 academics that we use for peer review. If your name's on that list, that's a good thing, promotion. So all of these things are kind of extra things that you might do over and above your research and teaching and admin and all the other stuff the university makes you do. It gives you a more rounded CV. It makes you more attractive, and you're going to get promoted. Did I say promoted enough? You're happy, aren't you? So esteem is very much tied into the same thing. It's very similar. So it's all about raising the profile. It's something that might lead you on to, let's say, an external promotion, otherwise known as a new job. But it can also give you that position so that you are invited to do things rather than having to chase people. And I'm not saying that you'll be added on as an author and not do any work on it, but you might be invited to work on a paper and become an author. Yes, so I talked a little bit about a peer review college, for example, and that is something which quite often is made public. Quite often, peer reviewing on journals isn't something that's made public. There aren't many journals which list the reviewers that they've used because you don't want to know who they are, and if that's one person in your area, you probably know who it is. So I've put some, maybe I should put very few, but some journals do list the reviews that they've used. Yeah, not on that article, but over the past year we've used this. So it's that kind of peer review college, if you like. Most academics will say that they have done peer reviewing for a journal on promotion and so on, but there's kind of no way to back that up without asking their promotion. There's no information available on it. I mentioned the peer review colleges already, no need to go on to that. Most conferences, it may be maybe my area, some conferences have a conference committee. Quite often it's the conference committee that do the bulk of the peer reviewing. Some conferences also list all the people that they've used for reviewing the papers that are submitted. So again, there might be some information out there to corroborate your claim about this peer reviewing that you've done. And yes, you put it on your CV, of course, but it's that corroboration. And of course, as a university, we like to keep track of all this stuff, particularly as an administrator. I like lists of things, so wouldn't it be great if there was some way of me knowing all these wonderful things that you've been doing in terms of peer review, because then that's something that we can advertise. And thinking about that sort of research environment statement, it's kind of obvious, isn't it? If you've got 20 members of staff and two of them are involved in external peer review, that's not as impressive as if 90% of them are involved in external peer review. So that's the sort of thing that universities like to know about. So more needs to be done in that area, or at least I believe it does. So time. This is the one that the academics really love. Most universities now have a work allocation model or a time model, whatever it's called. And of course, it's the WAM at Kent. If you are lucky, it won't be considered part of your normal duties to do peer review. It will be an allocation will be provided for it. So you have time specifically set aside in your work allocation model. More likely than not, it isn't. But maybe if you're doing something that's high esteem, it might be that your head of department goes, oh, that's really good. I want to make sure that's done well. I'll give you some time for that and take you off some admin duties. And I can see the academics really nodding at the front on that one. What about if it's a whole load of work? And now you're going to nod this time, not shake your heads, honestly. So if, for example, if it was something like the REF, you're sitting on the REF panel for a year, maybe your institution might give you some time to do that. And in terms of payment for your time, or your institution payment for your time, then I'll leave that to the horrible slide at the end. So, money. Again, some, very few, journals or publishing outlets do reward their reviewers with usually reductions in. So maybe there's a reduction in page charges, or you get some, or you might get a some sort of, if you like, peer review miles towards APC. So there are those sorts of models. Maybe that's something that could be done more. Some, probably very few. Again, some conferences do. For the conference planning committee, and there's review involved in that, there might be a reduction in fees or even a waiver for one day or whatever. So again, there's a sort of potential benefit there, and maybe that means that you can leave the rest of the funds to go to the conference more easily from your institution. Some funders do pay reviewers. More likely they pay the institution, but there's money coming in. Of course, if your department receives money for your time, then of course they give you that time in the work allocation model, so that's all great. Some universities do indeed pay bonuses for these things. And it's a little bit contentious, but some do. And you're thinking, well, is that really the case? Well, it depends how you determine bonus. If it's money coming in to your department, it is actually additional money, and that can be money in pocket. More likely, the bonus is involved in an acceleration of the pay scale or something like that for something really important that you've done. For example, REF peer review panel, REF panel. It is very common to get paid as an academic if you review another department's environment, their research strategy. So again, it's another form of peer review, and there's quite a lot of money sort of changes hand on that. Sometimes it's a small amount, and sometimes it's a large amount. It depends how prestigious you feel the job is as to how much you think you should charge. And as I've said, the REF, the Research Excellence Framework in particular, it is very common that that would lead to promotion, which is more money. If you're doing internal peer review, it is very unlikely that you'll get paid by your institution to review an article or a project proposal from somewhere else in your institution, but some institutions do it. It's much more common to have that time allocation, and by much more common, I mean relatively rare. So, in summary, it isn't just about journal articles. It is all a bit ad hoc. There are no kind of rules and regulations about should we pay for peer review or not. Is time allowed? Is there some way of recording things? It's completely variable by the type of peer reviewing you're doing, by the institution you happen to be at, and even by the department or the group. Some different departments in the same university do things entirely differently, even if it's physics and chemistry, just because of the way they're set up or the funding that they have in their department. There is no systematic recording system, and I'm very unhappy about that, but there are some developments, and potentially we could see how it could be done going forward, and we've heard things about, you know, identifiers. So, for example, ORCID identifiers would be a good way of gathering these things together. So that's probably just about all I wanted to say, and I guess I'll leave you with maybe a slight titter, maybe not. No, that wasn't funny. That wasn't funny at all, Simon. Thank you.
Ah, good morning. Well, thank you for having me here to talk today. As it says, I'm currently a Leverhulme Research Fellow based at the University of Bristol, but I've previously held fellowship at Cardiff, and before that I worked in Southampton as a postdoc. So I'm based in Earth Sciences, and most of what I'll be talking about today is really from a journal, focused on journal peer review rather than anything else, because that's what I most frequently come into contact with. But what I hope to give you is a fairly sort of honest perspective from an early career researcher on a lot of the topics and the pressures that we face associated with peer review. And there have been big changes in not just the way that the system works, but also what's expected of us, even over the last 7 years that I've really been involved with the process. And I'm going to try and cover today what we really want from peer review. And this will touch in part upon some of the issues that have already been spoken about this morning, but also what are our issues with peer review, and ultimately what might be the way forward. And the little cartoon just down in the right-hand side really sort of summarizes sometimes what peer review can feel like, where the third review, it's always bad, I don't know why. But ultimately what we do want from peer review is we want to improve our research. And in the science, or the Sense About Science survey from 2009, which was really one of the most comprehensive independent surveys, I think it included something like 4,500 academics, over 90% of them really did feel that the process of peer review improved their science, so it clearly does have an important role to play in what we do. Not only that, but certainly as an early career researcher, it really does give you that stamp of approval. It's that check that sort of lets you know that you're not putting something out there that's potentially garbage. And it also helps with to improve the dissemination of your research depending on the type of journal that you get into. So that was those three in black are really our ideal scenario of what we want peer review to do. The honesty, or the honest truth, is shown in red. Ultimately, we want to get through the process as quickly and as painlessly as possible, because ultimately, we want to publish in the highest impact journal possible, get it on our CVs to get one of those really elusive permanent positions or grant applications. Because when it comes down to it, the old adage, publish or perish, has never been more true than it really is today, particularly with the metric-based systems to evaluate us, not just for jobs, but the ref. But when you first start out, there really are a lot of questions and sort of self-doubt associated with the whole process. In particular, am I doing a good job as a reviewer? Most people, in fact, 56% of scientists reported that they get very little help on peer review. And actually, certainly from my experiences and a lot of my colleagues' experiences, there is no formal training, or certainly there wasn't. The system is getting a lot better because journals now do start to have web pages that tell you a little bit about what they actually expect of you as a peer reviewer. But for the most part, you're really relying on things like internal lab groups, where you learn about the process of peer review with your colleagues by talking about recent papers, the pros and the cons. Actually, very little of it is formal training by senior colleagues. And equally, not just acting as a reviewer, but in terms of being a reviewee, I would generally say that, you know, sometimes it can be really hard as a reviewee, and I think people need to remember that what they put out there, how they would feel if they received it in commentary themselves. But particularly challenging is when you put out something that really challenges the status quo. It can be very difficult to get it published. It can take many years, and actually that can kill a career. And this was an open review that one of my friends had, that they were trying to get something new out there, but the reviewer's comments was, they attempt to overcome this lack of constraint with rich imagination and a blitz of convoluted reasoning. And unfortunately, this isn't enough. It did finally get accepted, but it did take a long time. And more seriously, actually, some of the events this year really highlighted that there are biases within the process. And none sort of, the most extreme case was two young female postdocs who submitted a paper, and the review they received was relatively inappropriate. So things like, I won't go into any more details than that, but I would argue that that's a classic situation where double blinding would be an extremely powerful tool and should perhaps be a little bit more widespread. And ultimately, when it comes down to peer review, you have to think, or we have to think about the time we spend peer reviewing, because it's not a quick and easy 1 hour task. You know, it's time not spent writing papers, writing grant proposals, bringing in cash that's going to ultimately get you your promotion or your fellowship. And in part, I think Simon, one of the things that he really raised is we really need to start to come up with a means of recognizing the work that we do put into this, and particularly measuring it, because when you put it on your CV, people will review something to have that journal in their CV, but there's no difference between reviewing it once and reviewing 10 times for the same journal. Will people read my work? Yes, this is one of the things that in the sort of age of metrics, where ALPMetrics are becoming more and more popular, but also you want to increase your citations, you want to increase your H impact factor. So the journal that you ultimately decide to publish in becomes all important, and of course, its impact factor. And one thing that hasn't really been touched upon, but is increasingly becoming a problem, particularly for people like myself, where we're not part of we don't hold large grants, we're funded by independent, small research fellowships. Can we afford to publish our work? And I don't know anyone that actually doesn't believe that open access is the way forward. And I think the recent progress in that direction is brilliant. And I think it's definitely what we should be doing. But as we move to online models, particularly those that require payment upon entry, when it's turning out to be, to publish one paper, half of your research income for the entire year, it becomes really challenging and starts to actually affect where you're ultimately going to publish, which affects your impact factor, which ultimately is going to have a knock-on effect on career. And there are solutions, some of which are easy, some of which have already been touched upon. As an initial entry point to just making the process or getting more people into peer review, particularly sort of late-stage PhD students and very early career postdocs, just making it, removing the fear factor, essentially, which is what puts a lot of people off, the pressure of, am I letting something through that I shouldn't be? Am I actually doing a good job of reviewing this? By addressing that fundamental issue, I think we'd actually help to relieve some of the pressure. When I first started, I was always given the guidance that for every paper you submit or a co-author on, you should review a paper in return. That dynamic no longer works or stands true in any way. The demand far outweighs sort of your submission rates. And in terms of other small things that we can do other than to improve training, there's the idea of providing online courses, formal university sort of level courses for introductory people, so people that have been long-term reviewers or served on editorial panels, perhaps. Also, some journals are having quite interesting ways of doing open review that are particularly appealing. So eLife is a life sciences journal that does exactly this. And essentially what it does is it has the senior editor that provides a review and then a specialist reviewer. And for early, and essentially what they offer is that after you've both written your reviews, you get together and you have a discussion and produce a single review that then goes to the lead author of the paper. And in that process, you get feedback on what you're providing, are you working at the right level, and all of those kind of really important sort of that helps towards the learning curve and removes the fear. I did read on the internet about the idea of accreditation. So for example, that senior scientists might work with more junior scientists to help them on their first few reviews, and after those have successfully been completed, that journals might actually put them onto sort of a list of approved reviewers for independent working. But from talking to people that actually are editors, the idea that you sort of essentially add an additional barrier to the peer review process to slow it down because senior scientists are so busy, would actually not be potentially a great way forward. Also, things like cascading manuscript reviews, which have already been mentioned, they're easy to do potentially, but it could save so much time and is nothing more frustrating than giving a review for one journal and then being asked to review the same paper by another journal without any changes having been made. So if we could find a way to work cross-family, in terms of cross-journal family, to make reviews available, that would help a lot. Open peer review would help not just for evaluating what people have said about it, but actually for those of us that are still learning, you can look and see what a review even looks like, what should I be aiming for? And again, as we said before, recognizing reviewers' efforts is increasingly important. Getting a bit more extreme, I think the sort of impetus is there to start making some large changes. And the the pre-publication server idea that was talked about by John is particularly appealing. To get that kind of system up for all journals or for all disciplines would be great. And ultimately, you do have to ask that if we can get that system working very efficiently, everyone starts using it, do we actually, particularly if we have a commentary system within it, do we even need journals anymore? Can we just work straight from this sort of preprint or review server? And ultimately, in the long term, we have to think about things like the DORA-type agreements, whether or not we can get more of those kind of agreements. So the Declaration on Research Assessment that argued that impact factors weren't necessarily the best way to value science. I think we actually need more of these kind of agreements that take a more holistic approach to evaluating scientists and what they do and their contribution to their fields. And part of that would be recognizing their community efforts. And I think that's pretty much me done, except I would just say that it's actually quite an exciting time to be involved with these kind of debates, because things are changing and they're changing relatively fast. But it is, I think, really important that we do all engage through the various fields of publishers, the scientists themselves, and hopefully we'll find a new and exciting way forward that will make all of our lives easier. And for anyone that wants to find out more about the Sense About Science survey or other perspectives from early career researchers, some sources are just shown here. Thank you.
You might as well all stay up, come on up. We have about 15 minutes for Q&A from you to us, from us to us. You should all make sure your mics are on. Questions from those in the room? David, I think we have microphone runners.
Thanks, John. So I met with an editorial board of a journal I work with, a healthcare journal, fairly traditional journal. And one of their core principles, this is last week I met with them, one of their core principles is we only publish original research. We don't want to publish anything that's already been published. When someone submits a paper, they run it through one of these plagiarism detection software packages. Is this already out somewhere else? And they are really struggling right now because there's a growing trend of people, you know, posting their manuscript on their personal website, posting it in a preprint server like Archive, BioArchive. And in their case, because it's a healthcare journal, there are patient advocacy sites and there are policy groups where people will post a white paper, and it does go through some level of editorial review before it gets posted on those sites. So my question is, where is the line drawn? When is something previously published? And or is that just an archaic concept, I guess? So, thoughts?
Do you want to start with that, Tom?
Sure. David, that's, as always with your questions, a good one. I think this is the, when patient outcomes are involved, when health outcomes are involved, then I think this is a particularly difficult issue. I mean, I started my publishing career at The Lancet, and, you know, the medical journals were the ones that were the inventors of things like the Ingle Finger Rule and so on, which were designed to protect the public from wrong information or too early information that couldn't be interpreted by practitioners. I think I don't have an easy answer to your question, but I do think that there needs to be a distinction made and a clear distinction made in everybody's minds between the process of dissemination and the process of validation. And we are extremely clear about the fact that it's journals that do the validation for all the reasons that you've heard from the speakers, and that, you know, maybe this is just the concerns that your organization is expressing are just another consequence of being in the internet age.
One of the I love hearing about these preprint servers that we don't have in my discipline of history as yet. But what it strikes me that when we talk about them and worry about whether they are an early form of publication or not, to me they're not early form of publication. They're the new means of communicating for that scholarly discussion that you have at seminars, at workshops, at conferences, but they're opening that up to the entire world rather than just the people who are here in this room. And if we think of the preprint server as providing that opportunity for discussion in the process of doing research rather than seeing it as early publication, then I think that might be kind of more helpful.
I think it's a useful heuristic to, because it suggests that the discussion that happens on these servers is key to their mission, as opposed to the validation that happens in peer review.
Yeah.
And second question, Michael?
One subject that hasn't come up very much in the presentations so far, apart from that terrible example from PLOS One, is misconduct by reviewers themselves. It is, sorry, can people hear me?
You said misconduct, we heard that.
Yeah, and it's one of the issues that comes up in the reviews and in the surveys of researchers. They're worried about misconduct, about reviewers trying to scoop them, for example. How much of a problem is that from your perspective, and what are the potential solutions?
I would say, at least in my field, being scooped is not a major issue. It takes so long to generate the kind of data sets that we work with, that, and we have such limited material to work with, that we all know what everyone's doing. But the pre-publication servers, for me at least, are definitely a way of solving that.
I mean, Michael, I would answer that by saying that editors are highly aware of the potential for misbehavior, and it's part of their job and part of their mission to make sure that their journals don't fall victim to that kind of misbehavior, because it's an ultimately damaging thing for a journal to experience. So I'm not saying that it doesn't happen. I have to say that the journals that I'm involved in, where there are lots of discussions about these sorts of issues, the kind of ghastly scenario you describe is never raised as a problem. So it's a potential problem, I agree, but the extent of it, I have no idea, but I suspect it's small.
First of all, I really, really enjoy this program. I think this program is best program in this conference. In my experience, I'm very interested because, you know, I am a journal editor, so some you know, topic difference from history to the right now the policy, everything is very interesting. But and also I want to share, you know, as an editor, on how to treat the peer review. I often heard some scientists said, in the current time, they have so heavy work. Before maybe 1 year, they can do only peer review about 10 or 20 people. But now it's 1 month. They must treat about same work number. 1 month maybe must treat about 20 or papers. So they said they can't, you know, guaranteeing the quality. So this is maybe the current program, the current times problem. And also I have, you know, for my journals, in order to, you know, give the peer review permission, like second gentleman said, we just put the peer review on our list, on our web list, and also in the Christmas day, we usually send them the Chinese cultural card. because, you know, according to the international peer review system, so I think we can't pay them money because, you know, we don't have so much money to pay. Every year, maybe in my journal, we have three English journals, about more than 10,000 papers contribute to our journal. So you see, so much work, each paper we must depend on two or three comments that we can make the decisions. So I think this is peer review is not only for our published area, and also for the scientific area. So maybe I just want to know, John, you said we must establish some system. I think I really want to know what's your good idea. What system? Only for our joint published area? I think we should put forward some system for the scientific manager agency. Because the second gentleman said, maybe no, we should give them promotion, esteem. So some young people, young generation in the scientific area, they maybe should take the as a peer review, as a reputation. So whether we can supply some suggestion for the manager system. And actually, in my experiments, I found that most of peer review take this work serious. For example, for myself, someday I get a peer review from science. The paper focuses on the China published area. At the beginning, I really want to return because I think I'm not so high level to peer review the science papers. But my husband is a scientist. He said you can't get up this important work. You can learn something. You can, if you have meet something, you can ask a scientist. They focus this topic. So I think most of scientists and research take peer review is important work.
So I think the question is there a mechanism?
First gentleman, I'm interested for how to establish the system. Thank you.
We'd all agree that the current mechanisms of peer review are not fit for purpose in the 21st century, and the experiments they alluded to are all in their various ways attempting to deal with that. We could talk about this afterwards, because I know there are lots of other people who would like to ask questions. So if you'd like to talk over the coffee break more, I'd be happy to do that.
Phil, did you have a question?
Thanks. Before I get to my question, I just wanted to go back to... Yeah, I'm going to talk for a few minutes. Now, I'm just going to go back to the previous question about reviewer misconduct. And I just wanted to kind of give my perspective on that. And I think John's right that it varies enormously from field to field. But when you're in a very, very competitive field, I used to experience, and my colleagues used to experience, quite a lot of reviewer misconduct, particularly more senior researchers being overly harsh and overly critical of new ideas from younger researchers moving up through the field out of a sense of kind of self-protection.
So bias rather than misconduct, would you call it?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, I feel like, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I would not call that misconduct. I would call that doing the job that the journal asked the reviewer to do. It's the editor's job to decide how to interpret those remarks. I mean, I think what the question that was being asked about misconduct is flagrantly unethical behavior. Going out of refusing to review a manuscript for 3 months while your laboratory catches up with the experiments that are described. That's the kind of thing that I think I would call that misconduct, and that's the kind of thing that I think we just don't know the extent of.
Yes, so that's a different sort of it. But I think there is a quality control issue in reviewer behavior when the motives for giving a negative review may not be in the interest of science, but are out of self-interest. But anyway, the question I was going to ask is, with being published in particularly high-impact prestige journals being more and more important, as Kirsty said, particularly for the advancement from early career stage into mid-career stage, I feel there's a sense in which the editors and reviewers of particularly high-impact journals are de facto responsible, in a sense, for who it gets to advance and who does not, in a way that wasn't true, you know, years ago. Now, is that situation fair on researchers, and is it fair on publishers?
Anyone want to take that one on?
Yeah, I would agree with that, and I would also say the same for funders as well. You know, so if you're, it's very difficult to get promoted without that top paper, but also without research funding. So if you look at the research councils or the Wellcome Trust, the people who review for them, they have people's careers in their hands. I don't think it's any different to how it had been before, though.
One of the things that I note about a lot of modern peer review is that this question of, well, who is a peer? Who are the people doing it? When it was done by societies, within societies, society members, at least you knew roughly what type of person it was. You didn't necessarily know which fellow of the microscopical society it was, but you knew that it was someone who was at least esteemed enough to get membership of that society. So you could perhaps appreciate that they might be in a position to make a judgment. Whereas now, peers could be anybody working in that field of science anywhere. You don't know what career stage they're at, so when you get this anonymous review coming back, you don't know anything about that person. So you've lost that sense that at least you had some trust in what type of person it was. Now you don't. Now, I personally feel that some open peer reviews would help that. If people had to put their name to it, it'd be like when you give feedback to students. You don't destroy somebody. You try to give constructive criticism, and your name is on it. And if we thought of peer review in more in that sense, that might deal with some of these issues. Anyway,
I was just going to touch upon your comment about is it fair, and I would say between disciplines, definitely not. I'm very lucky, I work in earth sciences, so we're essentially told as early career researchers that if we want a job, we have to get 4-star papers. That's essentially, we're told, Nature, Science, you know, PNAS, PLOS. There are certain journals that we're expected to publish in to move ahead, and there are certain disciplines that you just could not publish in those fields, and those people do suffer. So I would say it's not a fair system.
The problem there isn't with the journals, it's with the reputational systems within our universities that we choose to reward Nature papers, Cell papers. It's
but
not
until
the
that
journal
changes,
system.
As early careers, we have to play the system. We need it to come down from the top.
Yes. Then the system will never change.
But the system has changed.
It has.
I mean, the rise of the importance of Nature, Science, Cell is actually a very recent phenomenon. Yes. It has changed. Presumably, it can be made to change again if we just worked out how to do that.
Yeah. And I suppose the counter argument to support that statement is that if you look at where things published in the ref were published compared with whether they got 4-star, 3-star, then there is a correlation, but it's not 100%, it's about 60%. So.
I mean, I think picking up the point that was already made, if there is blame here, I would place it squarely at the feet of the institutions concerned or the departments that are making those hiring decisions. And, you know, it is certainly true that we have a system in which being published in a high-impact journal is a proxy for the importance of value of the science. And anybody who's an expert practitioner in their field knows that that's simply not true. So hiring committees in academic institutions should be highly aware of that and not be fooled by this obsession with high-impact journals.
One more question in the back.
Hi. I did want to echo Helen's thanks to you. Fantastic, fantastic discussion. Thank you very much. I'm Alice Meadows from ORCID. One of the points that Aileen made that I thought was really interesting was that we are lacking a clear understanding or definition of peer review, which I think is very true. This came up in some comments on Scholarly Kitchen yesterday as well. And I wondered whether the rest of the panel agree. If so, is it feasible to address that? And if so, how?
One thing I forgot to say, and it was a very glaring omission in my presentation and my list of, you know, the things that the innovations in peer review was, and I'm surprised Mark Johnson hasn't already told me this, is that PLOS established, I think they were the first to establish this notion that novelty, importance, and so on was not a criterion for the judgment that was to be applied to a paper. It was scientific soundness alone. And that's, you know, to your point, Alice, I mean, that's probably where we should start, and then every journal can iterate based on that. How important do they want to make novelty, and how is novelty an important judged and assessed?
Other comments on that question?
I mean, yeah, just to support that, it depends on what the journal or the publishing outlet wants from that, and what the review is for. And so it would be quite difficult to have a single definition, I think. I think it's a definition, I suppose, a bit like the open access policy of the journal will vary what's, and there's no single definition for what an open access policy looks like. It would be the same for peer review. I guess going back to the ref example, I mean, they're explicit. It's significance, originality, and rigor. But those aren't necessarily things which are required for every outlet or not given equal weighting.
But notice not necessarily truth. Originality, absolutely. Significance, mm-hmm. Hopefully true or nearly true, but that's not what you're expecting the ref panelists to be able to judge. Exactly. So it's not, anyway, it's going to be questionable what you're actually judging, because I think so much of the critique of peer review has come from the biomedical sciences, where the truth value is important. If you're playing with people's lives in drug trials and things, then you can see why they have become very, very concerned in those fields about the accuracy of reporting. Whereas in many other fields, there's much less critique of peer review because it seems to be working broadly well in some of the more descriptive and field sciences and the humanities as well.
All right, Mark, since you were called on from the panel, go ahead. That I think this has to be the last because we're out of time.
Great, thanks, John. Mark Johnson from PLOS. Two comments and a question for you. So the first,
no,
I'll do it really fast,
answer.
John. The first comment is I thought that the ref research was really significant, and it was really interesting to go through the data of the publications that were reported as the high quality output. And we noticed with interest that PLOS One was listed as most frequently right behind PNAS. So we were pleased, because that seems to indicate that OA in the UK is thriving. Second comment is I think that what John was alluding to, Inglis, about PLOS is the PLOS One criteria is fundamental soundness of the research. And I think that points out the challenge that reviewers have, because we're asking them to decide, is this article appropriate for this journal? And that's a big burden on reviewers, because they have to understand the editorial criteria independently for each publication, rather than, is this an article that's good for my field? And that's, I think that's a concern that needs to be addressed. And then the final question is, there are other fields that approach peer review completely different. And I'm thinking of the art world, where you have the artistic critique, which is a face-to-face discussion of your art. And artists are actually trained to both provide valid feedback to their colleagues and how to receive that kind of constructive criticism. And I wondered if the group has considered that type of face-to-face approach and how it might be applied with peer review in the 21st century. Sciences.
So the first thing to say is, of course, we have that already, PhD thesis defense. So, but it would be interesting to, and you do also have that in project proposals as well. Quite often there's a two-stage process, there's a shortlist, and then there's an interview where the last four are whittled down to two. But yes, interesting for publication.
I wonder whether it will work with the demand for the sheer volume of people coming through, so logistically.
I mean, I think that's a function, it should be a function of conference presentations. And I mean, Cold Spring Harbor's been having conferences since the 30s, and even older hands than I tell me that these days the discourse is far more decorous than it used to be. And that when in the great days of the early days of molecular biology, the bigger beasts of the jungle who would be sitting in the front row would just simply get up and walk out as an expression of disapproval of the work being presented. People tend not to do that these days.
All right, well, thank you very much. I appreciate the panelists and the audience. Thank you.